Welcome to WXTV, your online source for weatherization training. In today's episode, we'll be focusing in on working with lead-based paints and how to do it safely. The Department of Energy has established their minimum criteria for working with lead-based paints that they call Lead Safe Weatherization, or LSW for short. Now, EPA has followed up with their own rule called Renovation, Repair, and Painting, or RRP for short. We want to examine the similarities between the two, as well as the differences, by working our way through the 12 steps that you need to take to work safely with lead-based paints. Homes built prior to 1978 require special consideration by weatherization crews. Before that, lead was used in paint for all surfaces of the home. It improved durability, corrosion and mold resistance, and enhanced the color of paint. The older the house, the more likely that lead will be found. While it was a great additive, we now recognize the health hazards associated with lead-based paints. When it's disturbed by cutting, drilling, scraping, heating, or sanding, dust is generated that can be inhaled or ingested. This dust causes permanent damage to workers and occupants, especially children. In 2001, the Department of Energy established a set of minimum lead safe weatherization, or LSW, standards. This minimized the generation, spread, and retention of lead in the weatherization workplace. Then in 2010, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency enacted the Lead Renovation, Repair, and Painting Rule, or RRP.
Lead safe weatherization is a series of practices and procedures to make sure that we do not make a lead paint hazardous situation worse in a home.
Hi, I'm Rob DeSoto and I work in the Weatherization Assistance Program at the Department of Energy's Golden Field Office. There has been some confusion in the weatherization program regarding the difference between LSW and RRP and the roles of workers, certified renovators, and training required for both. Let me try to clarify the main differences. The program guidance for 2010 states that all weatherization workers and contractors working on homes built in 1978 or earlier must have undergone LSW training and must follow the DOE minimum standards in their work as defined in the grant guidance. The RRP is a federal law promulgated by the EPA and is to be enforced by the EPA. All certifications related to the RRP, including certified firms and certified renovators, must be conducted by EPA-certified training facilities and follow EPA-approved curriculums. Each weatherization job site for impacted homes, those built before 1979, must have a certified renovator oversee the work activities, which are the LSW procedures, and must certify that the activities were conducted as required by the RRP and that final cleanup and testing was done, leaving the house at acceptable standards.
So we've seen some of the history, and we've heard DOE's perspective on it all. Now let's jump right into those 12 steps for working safely with lead-based paints. We're in the lab here at WXTV, and this is where all of our hands-on and classroom trainings take place. And that's just it. That's the very first step in this whole process, training. So both of these rules have very specific requirements for training. LSW requires a minimum of 8 hours of training. Now RRP, the EPA rule, also requires a minimum of 8 hours of training, two of which must be in a hands-on setting, going through 12 specific skill sets. So a lot of similarities there, just a few differences for that first step of training. Step two is determining the age of the property. Now this is pretty easy to do. You can usually just take a look at building records and find out the year that the property was built. The magic number that you're looking for is 1978, because at that time the Consumer Product Safety Commission banned the use of lead-based paint in residential and child-occupied facilities. Now step three is determining whether or not lead is actually present.
With either rule, you can always just assume lead is present and treat it accordingly. The Department of Energy has traditionally operated this way. Testing was not considered an allowable expense with weatherization money because it had to be done by XRF or paint chip analysis, which can be expensive. But now that RRP has come along, the power to test is in the hands of the certified renovator using EPA-recognized test kits. Using this method, testing is the same for both rules and now an allowable expense under LSW.
It's done with a test swab that looks like this. All swabs must be approved by EPA prior to use. This one here is a lead check swab by Hybervet Systems. Let's take a look. If you open up the inside, you'll notice that there's a liquid component, and over here there's a powder. Your job as the certified renovator prior to testing is to mix those two up. And you do that by simply crushing the two ends, flipping it up, and shaking it for 30 seconds to a minute. Now we'll kind of skip a few of those seconds and take a look inside. You'll note that bright orange color. What you're looking for is a change in color indicating that lead is present. So as you swab your surface, if this remains orange, there's no lead there and you can go about business as usual. But if it turns from this orange color to a red, you know that lead is present and you need to evoke lead safe work practices. For testing, you want to make sure that you're testing all of the components that will be disturbed during the renovation process. So in this case, we're going to replace the inside of this window just doing a retrofit. So we won't be disturbing the trim that's going around the window, just the interior here. But that's important to note. You notice you have two different painting histories here. If you are going to be disturbing additional components, you want to make sure that you're testing all of those components that have a different painting history. So let's check it out. We've got some plastic on the floor, and what I like to do is, just before testing, take a little plastic bag and put it under the piece that we're gonna check out here. That way you can catch anything that you're gonna be cutting. You want to take a knife, you want to cut at an angle, that way you're exposing as many different layers of paint as are on there. And you want to cut this out. Go all the way down to the wood. And of course, this is a destructive process. So you want to make sure that the homeowner knows before you're doing this that this is going to be taking place. So as you can see right here, we've got this all exposed. And that's the area we're going to test. So we've got our testing swab. Going to want to squeeze some out. You can see a little bit coming out there. As you can see, we are not getting a color change. We just still have this faint orange on there. So no lead is present on here. We'd be able to go about business as usual. But what we want to do is make sure that this is actually working. So when you order these, you actually get a little card here. And this card does contain lead. So what you're going to do is test to make sure your test swab is working. As we rub it on one of these circles here, you can see that you're getting a faint red color. Sometimes it's a little darker than that, but clearly it's red. That means that this is working because this card contained lead, and so we're good to go on this job. Want to dispose of these? It's the other reason for having this baggie here. I can take that with me. Step four is all about educating the client. And you're going to want to do that with this. Renovate right. Both LSW and RRP require that you hand this out to the client prior to starting work. You can hand deliver it or you can use certified mail. But remember, if you're going to hand deliver it, make sure you don't do it too early. You can't get it to the client more than 60 days ahead of the job. And if you go ahead and use certified mail, make sure you pop it in the mailbox at least a week before starting. Now this is for lead-based paint activities. And when we went ahead and tested this, we noted that we did not have lead on this surface. But let's imagine that lead was present after our test. This is a window. Both rules will require that we go ahead and set up containment. With LSW, since it's a window, this is going to be a level 2 containment. With RRP, it is going to be containment simply because it's a window. We're not going to measure this out. But say we're working on a wall, like this wall right here. If we were going to disturb this painted surface and it had lead on it, we're going to measure out the amount of surface area that we're disturbing. Both rules, LSW and RRP, have an interior de minimis size of 6 square foot. So for LSW, for instance, if we're below 6 square feet of disturbed area, we're going to treat that in most cases as a level one containment, putting plastic on the floor. Now that may change if we're using different tools like power tools and such. We may bump that up to a level two. It's really just a guideline. With RRP, that de minimis size of 6 square feet, if we're over it, we treat it as a lead-based paint activity and set up containment. If we're under it, technically we don't have to treat it as lead. Exterior, if you're going to lift some siding or drill some holes to blow these walls, you want to look for 20 square foot or less exterior. If it's less than that, you don't have to treat it as a lead site according to the RRP rule. More than that, of course, you do have to set up containment. For LSW, again, level one, level two, you pretty much are always putting up containment under those DOE rules. Step five is placing signs and barriers. A barrier might be simple tape, like this caution tape here. Signs need to read caution, lead renovation work, do not enter, no eating, drinking, smoking, things like that. You want to have these in the language of the folks who are going to be reading them. So you don't want anyone walking into your work site.
While RRP does not have a specific setback for signs and barriers, LSW requires 5 feet when possible.
And 20 feet out from your work site on an exterior setup. Step six is containment. Now, containment involves keeping the dust that you're generating in the work area from migrating out into the clean area of the client's home. This can be done in a lot of different ways. Both LSW and RRP provide guidelines for setting up containment, but they aren't going to tell you exactly how to set your containment up in the various scenarios that you're going to see.
Floor containment requires 6 feet of plastic out in all directions from the work area, if space permits, unless it can be reduced by installing a vertical wall.
So I've laid a sheet of 6 mil poly on the floor, and now what I'm going to do is tape this around underneath my work area. Now, if there was a baseboard here, we want to make sure that we tape this poly up just above the baseboard. We don't want that dust settling down on the top of the board or getting behind it. We've got our floor plastic in place. We want to make sure we move out anything we haven't already taken out of the area. Don't want this to get dirty. We also want to cover up anything we're not working on. We're not going to be doing any work on this window here, so we're going to go ahead and cover it. As you can see, we're treating this like a full containment, a level two or a full RRP containment. The next step is to really put up our barrier wall, preventing entry into the workspace. A lot of different ways to create a doorway. This is just one that we like. What I've done is created an eye to reinforce the cuts that we're going to make in just a second. Of expansion rods like that, even one guy can set this up pretty quickly. Let's tape everything together. Couple of things to note about our doorway. If you'll take a look at the bottom here, we've integrated our doorway plastic with the floor plastic. We've gone ahead and left a gap on the bottom of our eye door up 4 to 6 inches to make sure any debris that's coming through here isn't going to just hop right on out. We've also added a flap. This flap needs to be weighted down at the bottom so it's hanging free. And any debris made in this area is going to hit against it. This is one of our innovations. We like to showcase other folks, but this one right here is just a simple piece of PVC that we use as a reusable weight for the bottom of our door flaps. It's easy to clean, nice and smooth. And to weight it down, we just have a piece of rebar in there. Couple of caps on the end and you got yourself a nice weight that you can use time and time again. Well, this is a great time to highlight this week's innovation showcase because it deals all with lead safe setups exterior. You just saw our interior setup. Now we're going to take a look at this portable trough system from Butte, Montana and see how it can work for you exterior. If you notice, you just got a couple of PVC uprights. Nice and easy, nice and cheap. Anyone can do this. Anyone can make it and set it up on a job site. We've got pinned in on all the legs here a height adjustment. There's another adjustment under here so that you can get your distance from the wall. And of course, the plastic just lays right across here. This cross member can be any length that you want it to. In this case, we're trying to contain any debris that's coming off the window. And then we just use a couple of quick clamps to set up our containment with the plastic just draped over there. On the wall side then, a few strategically placed staples will keep it contained. Great setup. One thing we should really point out on an exterior setup like this is that the RRP rule requires that you place 10 feet of plastic out in all directions. Clearly, this portable trough system doesn't do that. We have far less than 10 feet. So we're not really sure where innovations like this are going to fit into the EPA rule, but there are questions to EPA out there that'll hopefully clear that up. As far as LSW is concerned, this is something that the Department of Energy is quite excited about. It does a great job of containing the dust, especially in high wind conditions. Take a couple of scrap pieces of wood, toss them down in the bottom of your trough, and that's really going to hold it down in the wind. The other thing that DOE likes is that you're not walking on plastic. When you walk on plastic, whether it's wet, icy, snowy, whatever, it can be a hazardous situation for the worker. So this gives you enough room to work on this window, in this case, for instance, and it's collecting the dust and still being a safe environment. For the purposes of this episode, that's about all we're going to show on an exterior setup. Now let's hop back in and see if we have anything left to do on our interior setup. We're fully contained. Let's get to work on this retrofit. Step 7 is personal protective equipment, or PPE for short. Now both rules, LSW and RRP, require pretty much the same amount of protection for the worker. So let's take a look at Ben Jr., our PPE dummy here, and see what he's got on. If you notice right on top, he's got something covering up his head. You want to make sure that you have either a painter's cap or a hood attached to your suit so you can prevent any lead-based paint dust from getting in your hair and you taking it home to your family. Now for just showing you here, we do have a suit that has the hood attached, and personally I like these a bit better. If you take a look at Ben Jr.'s bunny suit here, he's got an open collar. Plenty of paint chips and dust can get down there into his street clothes. You don't want that, so you know, if you're a little more safety conscious, maybe go with the hood attached on your bunny suit. Next, you'll notice some of the other obvious items here. He's got on a pair of safety glasses to keep things out of his eyes. He's got on a respirator. We're going to talk about that in depth in just a couple of moments. Of course, we mentioned the bunny suit. There are a lot of different brands on the market. Some of varying durability, so you want to make sure you get one that holds up throughout your job. You want to get one that fits well, and as far as fitting goes, the bigger the better. These things are not a fashion statement, so you want to make sure you grab one that's big enough so you can move around and you're not ripping out the arms and so on. If we go down to the end of Ben Jr.'s arms here, we notice that he's also wearing a pair of disposable gloves. And of course, attaching that to the suit is just some duct tape. Nice idea there, very simple, easy to do. Following all the way down then, our PPE dummy has on a pair of booties, also attached, much like you saw those gloves up above. Again, like the hood, you can get a suit that has the booties attached. Now, again, if you don't have that, you've got this duct tape on there. If you do, we still typically recommend throwing on a pair of those disposable booties over top because they can keep these from blowing out on the bottoms. So let's take a closer look at this respirator. Taking a look at respiratory protection, you'll note that there are a lot of different styles out there. Anywhere from a full face mask or even a hood, all the way down to this little disposable N95. Now, some of these are going to be acceptable for work with the RRP and LSW rules, and some are not. Let's start with LSW. This N95 disposable mask is not acceptable according to the LSW rule. The bare minimum that you need working under the DOE regulations for LSW is a half face mask, P100, N100, or R100. Now the 100, you'll note in all those, means HEPA. When you're talking about HEPA, you're looking for a magenta color and you're looking for the number 100. What that 100 stands for is that essentially 100% of all particles 0.3 microns or larger are filtered out. Now in reality, it's 99.97%, but that's pretty darn close to 100, so that's where you get the number. The P, the R, and the N, that just stands for how much oil particulate these can be exposed to. So a P would be an oil proof, an N would be not for use in an oil environment, and then an R is somewhere in between. It's resistant to oil. If you take a look at some of the other aspects of this mask, you'll note that it has a rubber seal all the way around. Now these masks under the LSW rule need to be fit tested. Fit testing involves first getting a medical release to make sure that the individual wearing it is healthy enough to wear that mask, and then moving on and going through the OSHA standards to determine that it does indeed fit properly. The first thing they look at is to make sure none of this seal is touching facial hair.
Clearly, this is not the right mask for me.
So if I wanted to wear a mask like this, I'm going to have to shave. Or again, I can go with a different style of mask that may be slightly more expensive, but still be in compliance with the rule. Now for RRP, it does say that you can use a disposable HEPA mask. So it'd be a lot like this, but instead of N95 on there, it would either say N100, R100, or P100. One of these or one of these. Step 8 is being aware of prohibited practices. Now LSW and RRP treat this a little bit differently. LSW does not specifically prohibit the use of certain tools, but it does recognize that some tools will create more dust than others. So you see some of these sitting in front of me here. If you're using a tool that does create dust, you want to make sure, according to LSW, to either add a shroud attached to a HEPA vac, like you see here, very simple one, all the way to some very complex ones with this circular saw down on the end, collecting all that dust right at the source. But if you're not using a shroud attached to a HEPA vac, you can then bump up the level of containment. So you would bump up to a level 2, a full containment, and treat it like that. With RRP, they actually say that certain power tools cannot be used without an attachment to a HEPA vac, meaning a shroud and a HEPA vac setup. The other thing they say you can't use is heat. Basically, using open flame torching to ease up paint or window glazing, can't do that. So this is going to be out. And the other thing is that you cannot use things like power sanders, power planers, power grinders, needle guns, and abrasive blasters without having them hooked up to a HEPA vac. When we say HEPA vac, we're being very specific. Now here's a lot of different HEPA vacs that we have here on this table. There's plenty more out on the market. All kinds of sizes, shapes, Some of them, like this one, you can wear as a fanny pack. Others are going to roll on wheels. Some are just for dry use. Some are for wet and dry. You'll need to find one that works for your specific application. It is not a shop vac. Now, even if the shop vac says HEPA on it, meaning it has a HEPA filter in it, it does not meet the requirements under the rule. The rule states that it needs to be an actual HEPA vac, meaning that all of the exhaust is filtered by that HEPA filter. If you open up one of these, you can see that there's plenty of spots around here for air to escape. We've all turned on our shop vacs before and seen the particles in the sunlight that shoot out the back of them. You don't want that to happen when you're working with lead-based paint dust. Let's open up a HEPA vac now. The first thing you'll notice about a HEPA vac, aside from the obvious price differences, is that all of the pieces fit very tightly. Everything is gasketed. Now we can open this one up because we haven't used it ever on lead-based paints. If you have used it on lead-based paints, all of this needs to be done at your facility, not at the client's home, but at your facility and inside an enclosed bag. So you'll be working like that. You notice that there's a couple of different filters, and I've left a lot of the debris on these just so you can see how much it's picking up. The first one is a large particulate filter. These are inexpensive and are designed to do just that, to grab all the large particles coming into your vacuum. So you can protect the secondary filter. In this case, this is a secondary filter. Looks a lot like the air filter on a small car like a Honda Civic. And then if you look on the inside, you'll notice that there is a HEPA filter. This is the final step of filtration before that air leaves the vacuum. Let's close this back up and hop back into containment for step 9. Step 9 is the cleanup and teardown. Both rules go about it pretty much the same way. The first thing you want to do is go ahead and take your HEPA vac, and you're going to vacuum high to low. So you're going to vacuum starting with your highest spots here, working all the way down onto your floor plastic, and you're going to work your way out of the room. A couple things to note about the HEPA vac. First thing you'll note is that I'm using a nice wide wand here. If you've ever tried vacuuming plastic before, you'll realize why I'm using one like this. Really lets a lot of air displace across this wand, so you're not sucking up little chunks of plastic as you're going. And that's the other thing. That's one of the reasons why we have recommendations for 4 mil plastic on the walls. It's a lot easier to vacuum. The other thing you'll see is on the HEPA vac, I've placed poly all around the hose. Now, any tool that comes into your containment needs to be cleaned before it leaves containment. And it's pretty darn hard to clean up between all those crevices on a HEPA vac hose. So we like to cut a strip of poly about that wide, long, run it all the way down the length of your hose, and just secure it along that seam with a piece of duct tape. Then at the one end that you're using, go ahead and put a wrap of duct tape on there so it'll move along with the hose. Once you've completed the HEPA vac process, the next thing you want to do is mist down all of your plastic. Again, you're working high to low. The reason you're going to do this is because that mist will keep all of those fine dust particles captured in the water droplets. So when you're folding all this plastic dirty side in, you're going to keep that dust in there without it puffing out all over the place. So let's go ahead and take some of this down. Now we're always going to treat it very, very carefully. We want to make sure we're not getting any of that dust puffing out into areas where we don't want it. So for some of these, you're treating it like you're folding your best linens. We'll kind of drop this down here onto our floor plastic. And you see we've tried to keep it dirty side in. And we've tried to be pretty careful during the whole process. So once we've got our vertical walls down, or anything covering up vertical spaces, we'll go ahead and take out the floor plastic as well, going through those same motions. Now that we've got our containment down, we really just go through some of the same processes that we just went through for the cleaning. We're going to take our HEPA vac and we're going to vacuum high to low, working our way out of the room. And then we're going to go ahead and work on the wet cleaning process. And that's really two steps. The first is any vertical surfaces should be wet wiped. You can use disposable wet wipes for this and go ahead and put them in your trash. For the floor, you want to use a two-bucket mop system. So we have one right here. This has the clean side that we're going to use to actually mop the floor with, and then squeeze out all the extra dirty stuff into this second bucket here.
With carpet, cleanup requires a HEPA vac with a beater bar.
Now for LSW, they want you to clean the area you contained, and then go ahead and clean anything that could possibly be dirty from either walking back and forth through containment or whatever. With RRP, they have very specific distances. You clean the area that you contained plus 2 feet out in all directions. Step 10 is checking your work after you're done. The first thing you want to do is a visual inspection. Now they want you to take a flashlight, turn off the lights, and you don't want to just do this across the floor. Very difficult to see anything. What you're looking for is very small specks of dust that you may have left behind. So if you place the flashlight at an angle, like I'm doing here, you can usually pick up on tiny specks because every tiny speck is going to cast a much larger shadow. If you find any, you go ahead and you re-clean. HEPA vac, wet clean, and then move back onto this step again. If you don't find anything, you can move on to the cleaning verification. That involves taking a wet mop system like the one we have here and placing a wet mopping system cloth on here. And you're gonna do the area that you contained, again, plus 2 feet. And the way you do that is in an S motion. You can see that I'm overlapping. And how much you're going to do depends on how much you've contained. You want to make sure that you're doing no more than 40 square feet with one of these wet cleaning systems here. Once you've done that, you can hold it up behind the little window on our cleaning verification card that's provided by EPA. And if it's somewhere between how clean this first one is and how dirty the second one is, you've passed. If, like I'd say the case is with this one, if it's dirtier than this second one there, you have to go ahead and go through the cleaning process again and then do another cleaning verification. If you pass on that second one, you're good to go and you can check off that this is indeed clean. If, however, you failed on the second one, this means that you've cleaned once, you've done a cleaning verification once, you've cleaned a second time, and done a cleaning verification a second time. There may be something going on with the floor substrate itself. And so what EPA wants you to do is to let it dry for 1 hour and then go ahead and wipe it down with a dry, electrostatically charged cloth. Now remember, for RRP, only the certified renovator can perform the visual and the cleaning verification. Step 11 is waste disposal. Now, anything that you generate on site that's a solid waste needs to go into a heavy-duty plastic bag. If it's too large for a bag, you need to go ahead and wrap it up in plastic and seal it off. Now, one thing you don't want to do with these plastic bags is to take it and squeeze all the air out of it. You're going to end up with a plume of lead-based paint dust all over the house. But a good trick you can use is to take your HEPA vac, place the hose down inside there, and seal it off. And use that to suck out a lot of that additional air. Once you have gotten all of that, you want to go ahead and gooseneck it. So you start by twisting it like this. Once you've got it twisted, you want to take a wrap of duct tape around that. You're then going to gooseneck it. It gets its name from that bend, just like you see there. A couple of twists again, and another bit of duct tape. This is now ready to take to your secure waste disposal area. That means either you take it directly to the landfill or back to your own property, where you either have it in a locked dumpster or in a dumpster that's secured in some other way. Couple of notes on this. As you're walking through the client's home, you don't want any dust on the outside of this to shake all over the place. So if you happen to notice that the bag is dirty on the outside, which it certainly can be, take either your HEPA vac and vacuum it off, or you can take wet wipes and wipe it off, or even go a simpler route and toss it in a secondary bag so that the outside is clean. Water generated on site needs to be poured through a filter to remove solids and, of course, those can just get tossed into our bag with the other solids. And then that water can be dumped down the toilet. From a federal standpoint, whether it's a solid or a liquid, the waste generated on a lead-safe work site is considered a household waste and can be disposed of accordingly. But you always want to check the local regulations first. Step 12 is record keeping. Both RRP and LSW require it. RRP, for instance, requires that any records generated before the job be kept on site during the job, and then for 3 years after that. Now, cutting down on some of your paperwork is one of these. Having a digital camera handy to take pictures before, during, and after the job to ensure that you've done the job properly is always a good idea. That's all we have for this week's episode of WXTV. And please keep in mind that the purpose of this episode was to bring about an awareness of these two rules. We can't cover it all in the time frame that we have, so you're going to need to get yourself out to a formal classroom training on the subject. And hey, thanks for watching, and please take a look at the forums right down below our screen there and write a few comments in. Thanks. WXTV, your online source for weatherization information, techniques, and expert advice.